You're listening to What in the World
with Richard Garner
on Canada Talks, Sirius XM 167.
The only thing necessary for the triumph of evil is for good men to do nothing. Edmund Burke. The quote's been actually attributed to multiple people, but it's something that I think we'd all agree with. Yet, in the world we live in today, the people that have spoken out against evil, whether it be in government or corporations, generally institutional evil, haven't necessarily fared well. Whistleblowers, are they heroes? Or are they criminals? I guess it depends on your perspective. Tonight, the author of Whistleblowers, Broken Lives and Organizational Power, C. Fred Alford, tonight on What in the World, Sirius XM, Channel 167, Canada Talks.
Welcome back to What in the World with Richard Garner
on Canada Talks, Sirius XM 167.
Welcome to the show. Tonight, we're going to be talking about whistleblowers, and it's an interesting history, if you will. Relatively recent term, although most people are familiar with it, it's really something that sort of pops up in the 20th century and got off to a pretty good start. Movies like On the Waterfront, Marlon Brando plays a guy that speaks out about union corruption on the docks in Hoboken, New Jersey. You know, there's The Harder They Fall with Humphrey Bogart, who, you know, is a sort of a down-on-his-luck reporter, ends up coming clean and sort of exposing, you know, a corrupt promoter who's, you know, fixing fights. And again, this was kind of looked at by most people in North America as something that was a heroic act. And fast forward to the year 2014, and that's become a little more complex with people like Edward Snowden, obviously Chelsea Manning, formerly Bradley Manning, looked at by some people as courageous people that stood up, spoke out for justice, especially when it came to issues like spying on the American people, etc. But you also have lawmakers in the U.S. that have publicly called for the execution of people like Snowden, Manning for treason as traitors. When you sort of leak into the corporate world, or let's say even corrupt cops, you have movies like Serpico back in the day where a young Al Pacino exposes massive institution-wide corruption in the New York Police Department, which led to, you know, many, many New York police being arrested, et cetera, prosecuted. And I think early on in the 20th century, again, this was looked at as sort of very American. You even fast forward to All the President's Men. Of course, that's a story about two reporters who ultimately expose Watergate and bring down a president. But it was looked at by many people as an act of courage, of putting yourself in harm's way to tell a bigger story about injustice against people that was for the greater good. Yet, as we sit here today in the year 2015, the true story outside of Hollywood for most whistleblowers is not, unfortunately, a happy ending. Many of them, after being fired from their jobs, end up suffering all of the things that you would expect anybody that challenges the status quo or institution. And although the cameras usually show up and you know, shed light on these people who have stepped forward and brought to the attention of the masses something that most people would agree, you know, was important. When things ultimately get to trial and move down the line, many of these people end up destitute, ostracized from society, and or worse, which would be dead. And in some cases, that ends up being either at the hands of themselves or, in other cases, suspicious happenings around, you know, the cause of death, etc. But it is a very interesting topic of discussion because in a democracy, you would expect that you have everything in place, the checks and balances, if you will. You have the regulatory bodies. All of these things are supposed to protect us from institutional corruption, but we know that the incentives lie often with shareholders, with profit, with whatever it is, and too often things that are endangering the public good are allowed to happen, except for that man or woman who stands up, puts themselves in the line of fire, and speaks out. Again, from one person's perspective, heroic. From other people's perspectives, not so much. The author of Whistleblowers, Broken Lives and Organizational Power is C. Fred Alford, and he's going to join us tonight to talk about not only this book, but this phenomenon, this sociological question about the role of the whistleblower in modern day society. And he joins us now. How are you, Professor?
Okay. How are you?
I'm good. And you know, obviously, this is something that is, you know, part of the purview of what you deal with as an academic. But you were obviously driven to the point of writing a book about this. What was the motivation beyond something that you had just sort of observed as something that wasn't necessarily being talked about enough? What was the motivation for you to want to sort of bring this to light?
Well, actually, it was the research I did for my previous book, which was called What Evil Means to Us, and it compared what a group of rapists and murderers thought about evil with what a group of ordinary citizens thought. And I got discouraged by that and decided I'd go look at some people who did some good. And I thought that whistleblowers were a group of people who'd overall done some good. And so I thought, well, gee, I'll go study them. And I didn't exactly know how to go about it, and I got lucky. Something called the Government Accountability Project ran a support group for whistleblowers who'd lost their jobs and were just trying to talk with each other and make some sense of what happened. And they let me sit in and listen to them. And that's how I got started.
So I'm guessing you go into this with an entirely different perspective, because obviously, like you said, you're looking actually, you know, profile some positive stuff to sort of lift the dark cloud that was around you in researching your previous book. And instead, you actually end up in another dark cloud, and that's the one that is the reality of the situation, not necessarily the perceived reality by society that, oh yeah, these people are taken care of, they're put on a pedestal, they're celebrated as heroes. And in fact, what you encountered was mostly the complete opposite, that many of these people's lives were shattered, not only in and around the time that this all sort of came to light, but even years afterwards.
Well, you know, that's right. I mean, I didn't come away, you know, entirely discouraged, but it was, you know, to be a whistleblower is not easy, though the statistics are difficult to come up with because it depends on how you define whistleblowers. It seems like about half of the people who blow the whistle lose their jobs, And if they lose their jobs, most of them are going to lose their houses. Most who lose their houses, their marriages are going to fall apart. And for many, they'll never work in their field again. That's a heavy price to pay. And one of the things that surprised me when I went into this whistleblower support group, it took me a while to realize that these men and women, the events sounded so real. I thought they'd blown the whistle, you know, a year ago or 6 months ago. And it turns out many of them had blown the whistle 10 or 20 years ago. And they were still, you know, so traumatized by these what had happened to them. It was like it was yesterday. And they couldn't, you know, get back on track. So, yeah, it's whistleblowers are not just fired, but in many cases they're pushed to the margins of society, unable to find work in their fields. It's not uncommon, for example, for someone who was a nuclear engineer to, find a new career selling computers or whatever they sell now at Radio Shack. It's tough.
And one of the write-ups for the book, you know, sort of paints an interesting picture because, again, this approach that you took, again, is coming from an academic perspective. So the sociology and the psychology of this as it pertains to the bigger picture of society is very interesting in terms of the approach. And I want to read what one of the reviews said. It says, few whistleblowers succeed in effecting change. Even fewer are regarded as heroes or martyrs. Alford mixes narrative analysis with political insight to offer a frank picture of whistleblowing and a controversial view of organizations. According to Alford, the organization, as an institution, is dedicated to the destruction of the moral individualist. Frequently, he claims, the organization succeeds, which means the whistleblowers are broken, unable to reconcile their actions and beliefs with their responses, the responses they receive from others. In addition to being mistreated by organizations, whistleblowers often do not receive the support from their families and communities in order to make sense of their stories. And what stands out to me here is that when you're making a claim that the organization or the institution is dedicated to the destruction of the moral individualist, that's a real serious claim, because this is the type of stuff, in my opinion, that should be 6 o'clock news stuff, because I don't disagree with you. And if you really look deep into it, as you have, that's almost the only conclusion that you can draw. Yet if you asked 1,000 people on the street, most people would say, well, that's, of course not. I mean, you know, everything, you know, institutions are set up with, again, checks and balances and regulatory, and if something's wrong, somebody's going to speak out, whatever. But your experience taught you a different lesson. Talk to us about what you came away from in terms of your overall understanding of the organization.
Okay. First of all, I think I disagree. I think if you ask 1,000 people on the street, that a number would understand that the organizations they work for are not looking for moral, truthful individuals. They're looking for loyal workers and employees, and that there's something, this covers all organizations, government organizations, private organizations, corporations held by stockholders, it doesn't matter. There's something about collective organizational life that seems to value loyalty above all else. And I think the trouble with whistleblowers is that they really show the rest of us, you know, sort of the our own, you know, how extensive our own cowardice is. I think many people have seen things that are wrong at work, and have simply not said anything because it's not worth it, because, as you said, often the whistleblower doesn't affect change, or because people understand that it's too costly. I've said everything you need to know about whistleblowing you learned in kindergarten, or certainly in the high school cafeteria. It's about the pain of exclusion, and it's about the power of groups to exclude and how painful it is, and at the same time, how willing groups are to make a sacrifice of someone who goes against the group, whether it's a group of friends in the high school or it's the organization. There's something almost primal about organizations that put loyalty above everything else. And I think the problem with a whistleblower and why Americans have trouble with whistleblowers is because the idea is admirable, someone who stands up and speaks out against a powerful organization. But the reality is that when you're in the organization, even when somebody does that, this loyalty comes first. People... we're the land of the free here in America, at least. We're supposed to be and I guess in Canada, too. We're supposed to be the land of the free and the home of the brave. But in their daily life, people act like moral cowards most of the time. They see things that are wrong, and they don't say anything about it. And they understand intuitively, I think, a fact that I found absolutely astounding, that you're almost as likely to get fired if you go to the boss's boss as if you go to the newspaper. I mean, you'd think it would make a big difference whether you work in channels or go outside channels and go to the newspaper or the mass media. It really doesn't make much difference at all in terms of your likelihood of getting fired. And that's because the organization has identified you who is somebody who's willing to commit the truth, as one whistleblower put it. And I think organizations see people like that as extremely dangerous. And I think people who work in organizations often intuitively know that.
It's quite terrifying. I mean, when you think about it, because, I don't think a lot of people are going to argue with the reality that you're sort of laying out. But, you know, the truth of the matter is the message is loud and clear, isn't it? It's don't rock the boat. This isn't necessarily something new, but we wouldn't want to acknowledge that we're this limited as a society in terms of exposing corruption. And again, we're not just talking about financial corruption in most of these cases, which of course can be damaging and is damaging to people. But in many of these cases, we're talking about people who've exposed health risks that, you know, in many cases, knowingly contributed to death, whether it be in a pollution sense or chemical product or pharmaceuticals or whatever, where you would be concealing a study that told you that there was a higher risk in putting this drug to market, et cetera, et cetera. So we're not just talking about stuff like money where somebody might go, what are you going to do, right? In this case, you're talking about stuff that would potentially damage people's lives. But again, the message loud and clear to everybody from what they see is that there is no upside, or there's very little upside to coming forward outside of this crazy notion called ethics.
Well, actually, it's a crazy notion called ethics, but my sense is whistleblowers don't experience it exactly like that. They don't say, I've got a tough ethical choice to make. That may be a way to reconstruct it. I call it choiceless choice. I'd ask whistleblowers, well, why did you do it? And over again, the answer was, well, I didn't have any choice. That doesn't mean they hadn't been thinking about it for a while. But at some point, they felt like they just didn't have any choice anymore, that they got up, they looked in the mirror one morning, and they knew that this was the day. I mean, some would say things like, well, it was speak up or stroke out, or it was giving me ulcers or this or that. But they didn't act like it was a moral choice. They acted like it was a moral compulsion. And I think that I came to the conclusion that actually most people aren't like this, and that we're fortunate that some people are, but these people pay a heavy price. And in fact, I came to the conclusion that what it takes to be a whistleblower isn't what it takes to be to survive whistleblowing. To be a whistleblower, I think you have to be a little naive. That is, you have to, you know, most of us grow up knowing that people say one thing and do another. Most of the whistleblowers I talked to, and this was partly just a result of the people I had access to, but I think it's generalizable, they were conservative, middle-aged, middle management men and women who sort of had naively expected that the way people, you know, say things are ought to be is the way they're going to be. One guy said, I wasn't against the system, I was the system. I just didn't realize there were two systems. And I think whistleblowers are often a little naive, and then they come up against this reality that, gee, people lie, and they lie by policy, and it's corporate policy to lie or deceive or whatever, and they expect that if they talk to the boss's boss or someone that of course they'll want to do something about it, and lo and behold, all of a sudden they're a whistleblower.
Yeah, and they're now the red flag that everybody's right. going to be paying attention to. We got a troublemaker in our midst. We're going to have to figure out how to weed that person out. We're going to talk about some of the specific stories that you encountered that stood out for you. When we come back, we're with C. Fred Alford, the author of Whistleblowers, Broken Lives, and Organizational Power. It is What in the World? Sirius XM, Canada Talks, Channel 167.
Talking about a revolution sounds whisper. Don't you know how talking about...
This is What in the World on Canada Talks, Sirius XM 167.
And welcome back. We're talking whistleblowers tonight with the author of Whistleblowers, Broken Lives and Organizational Power. It is C. Fred Alford with us. And before the break, you know, we talked a little bit about your general takeaway from the research you did, the people you interviewed to put this book together. What were some of the stories that really stood out to you that you know, whether for surprising reasons or you know, the people, whether it's an emotional connection, but what were some of the stronger stories that stood out to you?
Well, I'm Richard, I'm going to say that what struck me, I mean, I talked with someone who blew the whistle on a poorly constructed nuclear power plant, Maine Yankee, that eventually had to close down after almost melting down. I talked with some people in some dramatic cases. I talked with Daniel Ellsberg, the original
Pentagon papers.
The Pentagon papers. But I was struck in some ways by the average whistleblower, if there is such a thing. The average case of whistleblowing involves, in the United States, involves a case of Medicare fraud under $100,000. These people never even make the back pages of the newspaper, or you don't see them on the web. They disappear. And so, what was I struck by? I was struck by, as I said, how conservative many of these whistleblowers are. One was Robert Harris. This is a pseudonym. They're all pseudonyms. He was a retired major from the U.S. Army, and he continued working for the Department of Defense as a chief procurement officer. And he was asked to write a purchase order for a sole source contract. He objected, said that there ought to be competitive bidding. His boss agreed. Then the boss got a call from the Pentagon. We want sole source. Robert Harris was told to back off. He didn't. He kept calling people at the Pentagon. Never went beyond that level. And was, in fairly short order, given an evening shift, transferred to a job 60 miles away, told not to use the phone or fax. His computer was confiscated. A series of bad efficiency reports followed, and he was fired in about 2 years. And that's actually about the average length of time between blowing the whistle and getting fired, because the goal of the organization is to disconnect the act of firing from blowing the whistle, because it's not only a good thing, but it's a protected thing to speak out against sole source contracting when enough money is involved and so forth, that there ought to be competitive bidding. And the government protects that type of activity, and it protects the whistleblowers who speak out. But it can't really protect them, because all the organization has to do is make it miserable enough for the employee, put him under enough stress for long enough, and he'll do something silly, or he won't, you know, he just won't be able to put up with it, or give him a series of bad efficiency reports, and he's gone. Organizations have long memories. Individuals have shorter lives and generally even shorter financial assets.
This, and like you said, it's systemic, right? But you did also touch on the fact that technically whistleblowers are supposed to be protected, through very serious legislation, because it's recognized by the government that, at least theoretically, that the role of the whistleblower is there would, of course, need to be some sort of protection for somebody that's taking on such great risk, or else they will be buried by their employers, and they will, you know, they'll never be heard from again. So, you know, whistleblower acts and these types of things are put in specifically to make sure that this person has some degree of confidence. Let's say the person's even aware of it, first of all. But even if they're not, that these people, you know, somebody's got their back, so to speak, when they're taking on this, this man, you know, David and Goliath type story. But in your experience around the people that did, take on the fight, so to speak, did they really get that level of protection from the government later on in the legislative process or in the judicial process, or is it really more smoke and mirrors?
It's not so much smoke or mirrors. It's an area in which procedure rules, and it makes a great deal of difference in some cases whether you go to the government first or whether you go to the boss first. Sometimes you're protected only if you go to the government first, sometimes only if you go to the boss first. Procedure rules, and it's easy to get around the rules. But it's true, there's hundreds, there's probably actually over 1,000 laws protecting whistleblowers, including some significant reform in 212, as well as the Dodd-Frank financial protection legislation in the United States following the stock market crash. But it's easy to get around this legislation. It's relatively easy to fire someone you want to get rid of or to make their life so miserable that they want to quit. I was surprised at the actual number of whistleblowers who were given closets as offices. Wow. Or little cubby
literally like not even subtle indications that the
there's nothing subtle about it. You'd think it might be subtle. There's nothing subtle about it. One fellow was told to go into his office closet at 9 and not to come out till 5. And
wow.
Given virtually no work to do.
Like almost like some sort of solitary confinement.
Yes. It's really quite amazing. And again, organizations have long memories and lots of money. And whistleblowers simply can't compete. There was another woman, Laura Bastian, who worked. She also worked for the Department of Defense. I think government whistleblowers were overrepresented in my project because I did my research near Washington, or in Washington actually, but. She'd been a child psychologist evaluating special needs kids over in Europe on military bases. And she realized that there weren't nearly enough facilities to handle these special needs kids who needed a special education, the children of our servicemen and women. And so she complained first to her boss and then to some people in the Pentagon and in charge of this. And at first she got a lot of support. They encouraged her to tell her story. And then her boss got a call from someone higher up in the Pentagon and said, we're not interested. And all of a sudden everything turns 180 degrees. And she had a minder, as she put it, someone who followed her around, who wrote her up for a comment made to another colleague, not to the public, but just to another colleague, about a two-for-one special one day, meaning two children with the same disability on the same day came in, and that was seen as unprofessional and so forth. A couple of poor evaluations, and eventually she quit. And she spent $100,000 taking her case through the federal courts and lost on the last appeal. And the federal judge ruled that while she was treated improperly, that she was not protected under the Rehabilitation Act under which she complained.
Wow.
And her case was dismissed. So her day in court was, 10 minutes in court and $100,000. That's the norm. There are exceptions. Some people win. Most people don't. And even the people who win, almost all of them say they wouldn't do it again, which is discouraging. I teach university students, and I've thought quite a bit about, gee, could I teach whistleblowing or teach students to be more enthusiastic about whistleblowing, if I can put it that way. And I've decided that I can't. That once I tell them these stories and ask them what they do, they almost invariably say they'd be quiet, they wouldn't do anything, or maybe they'd quit. So even in, an abstract hypothetical basis, almost all of my students say they wouldn't do it. And in some ways, it's hard to blame them.
Mm.
And I think it's actually much easier for a younger person to blow the whistle than the people who blow the whistle and get hurt the hardest, and that is middle-aged people who've reached the level of middle management and they're able to see fraud or deception or whatever by policy.
Well, that's the crazy part is that you the janitor isn't going to be privy to the information
right.
necessary. You have to be in a position of influence, but not necessarily C-level influence. to be able to actually be aware of the malfeasance. So on, we got to take a break here, but on the other side of this, I really want to talk about what that last couple of minutes were, because I'm severely depressed as we sit here. So I'm looking to get something that might be able to, you know, offer me a glimmer of hope. But I can't overstate the importance of what you just said. When you have young, idealistic people at the university age who are most full of, you know, pith and vinegar, as they say, saying that they wouldn't even venture down that road, we got a serious problem in our society. It is What in the World, Sirius XM Canada Talks, Channel 167. No expression.
You're listening to What in the World
with Richard Garner
on Canada Talks, Sirius XM 167.
And welcome back. We're talking whistleblowers tonight with C. Fred Alford, the author of many books, but specifically a book about this particular subject. Also part of the Department of Government and Politics at the University of Maryland. If people want to find your work, Professor, where's the best place to go?
Amazon.com. I mean, I like to support my local bookseller, but they can order it from their local bookseller or find it on Amazon.com. I think that's the best way.
And not just you've written many books, and the reason why I think this is pertinent to this conversation is that you've dealt a lot with the idea of psychology of morality, as you put it. And
right.
I don't know how expansive that field is, but, you know, you've taken a look at a lot of different things, from human rights to just generally speaking, how is morality manifested, I guess, in a world of subjective values and relative and moral relativism, let's say. And that's the definition of a gray area, I would suspect. But this particular area, where, again, if you're going to go off of what Americans and how Americans, let's use the U.S. specifically for this example, because this is where I find the most sort of surprise or shock or dismay. If I was to write a quick summary of America and I was to incorporate X amount of the Constitution and the Declaration of Independence and other iconic American documents that spell out, what this great experiment, as they say, was meant to be. It would seem that almost everything in the DNA of whatever that document would be that I would come up with would indicate that someone who stands, because again, if you think about what America was built on, it was built on this rejection of this elite monarchy system that was about oppression, about this sort of divine right to rule and serfs and peons, etc. So the shift that happens not only in North America at that time, but really spreads to the rest of the world over the next, 300 years, is really built on that foundation, that it's about the everyman and standing up and doing what's right and all of those things. And obviously I'm preaching to the choir. It would seem to me that within that pantheon, the whistleblower would be automatically within the U.S. be considered a heroic person. It would just be automatic. Well, of course, yeah, this person's standing up and fighting for the people and fighting the good fight against the big institution. That's what America's all about. How do you explain psychologically how that is not the case?
I think it has to differs in part has to do with the difference between theory and practice. That in theory, Americans admire whistleblowers. They see movies about well, Karen Silkwood or someone like that, or the insider about someone who spoke out against the tobacco companies. But I think in practice, whistleblowers make cowards of us all. That they, when we see a whistleblower, we see what we're not doing. It's like looking in a mirror, only the mirror shows not, if we're not willing to do the same thing, if we know in our heart and soul that our job is more important to us, that looking good to the boss is more important to us, if being financially successful is more important to us, fitting in. And I think we underestimate sort of the sheer attraction or importance of fitting in. Then when we see the whistleblower, we're sort of caught in what psychologists call this cognitive dissonance, this conflict between two values, that one that values individuality, the other values fitting in. And so how do we resolve this dissonance? Generally, it's by making the whistleblower out to be, well, he's not that moral. She's not that good. It's not really that important. I'd blow the whistle if it were about something truly about life and death, and on and on and on. I actually did a little bit of study of whistleblowers in more group-oriented cultures, Korea and Japan. And people in those cultures understand better than we do sort of the lengths they're willing to go to fit in and belong to the group. The problem in America is that we have a set of values that values individualism and speaking out, but in practice we live in organizations that punishes that, and we don't want to get punished. We don't want to be excluded. We don't want to be left out of the group. And people have trouble with that, and so they often end up saying, well, the whistleblower's not being loyal, or it really wasn't such a big deal, or it didn't make any difference, or blah, blah, blah.
Yeah, or it's about the money, or it's interesting how quickly our default will go to something other than, whatever could be considered, the good thing or the moral thing, because to your point, it's like if you let's say you're hanging out with a bunch of people and you show up one day and you all used to drink together, and then you show up and people are like, let me get you a beer, and it's like, actually I stopped drinking. I mean, the initial inclination is to feel like that's a judgment on themselves. Yeah. It's like, instead of support, that's good. But really, you go away, oh, what's up with Buddy? He thinks he's better than us.
They are better than us.
Yeah, but,
disturbing. Whistleblowers are better than us. And you use a drinking example. I often thought in terms of another drinking example, that the whistleblower is generally not the sort of person I'd want to go out and have a beer with. Why? Because they tend to be obsessed and a little bit self-righteous. And there's nothing wrong with that. I mean, if that's what it takes for someone to do the right thing, and it does, average people don't blow the whistle, just by definition. It takes someone who's a little more obsessive, a little more a Dudley Do-Right or whatever you want to call him. It takes someone like that to speak out. The whistleblower doesn't have to be perfect, because there's always something wrong with a whistleblower. There's always something wrong with all of us. The whistleblower just has to be right, or at least, right enough. Mm. And in my experience, they generally were, though I met whistleblowers who blew the whistle on issues I didn't think were important enough to lose a job over.
Mm.
But that was their decision.
Sure.
They weren't making it up. I would have just said, this isn't worth losing your job over and your family's future and so forth. But in an awful lot of cases, it was. And that's the way it is. We owe a great deal to whistleblowers. We owe ultimately their willingness to be sacrificed for the protection of the rest of us because we're not truly willing to protect them. And I would say that, you know, one of my slogans was, take a whistleblower to lunch. Because one of the things that surprises whistleblowers the most is not that the company retaliates or the boss retaliates, but the people they've worked with for 10, 15, 20 years won't look at them anymore.
And bail on them like almost immediately. It's one of the saddest parts. We've got to take our last break. Be back more with C. Fred Alford. The book, again, is Whistleblowers. Sorry, I've lost my place here.
I can finish it.
Yes,
you.
Finish it for me, Fred.
Whistleblowers, Broken Lives, and Organizational Power.
Perfect. Thanks. We'll be back after this.
Welcome back to What in the World with Richard Garner
on Canada Talks, Sirius XM 167.
Our guest tonight was the professor of political philosophy, the University of Maryland, C. Fred Alford, and of course, author of many books, but specifically to this conversation, Whistleblowers, Broken Lives, and Organizational Power. We only got a couple of minutes, Fred. I just want to ask you, the term whistleblower, does that have to change? Because I find there's already a connotation there of something not heroic, shrill, if you will. Did anybody mention that to you? And do you believe that term, we'd be better off if we gave it a rebranding?
No, I don't think so. I think I'm not really sure. No one's really quite sure where the term comes from, by the way. Some attribute it to Ralph Nader, but I think it's actually a pretty good term. And I think as long as we understand the whistleblower is somebody who speaks out against immoral, illegal, or unethical acts where he or she works. And it can't just be acts against him or herself. It has to be acts that harm the public. And once you understand that, I mean, blowing the whistle, why not? Strikes me as a pretty good term. It gets complicated with people like Edward Snowden, who are whistleblowers, I think, by definition, and at the same time, they violated national security law. And to me, it's not a problem. I just say they're both, someone else is going to, each individual is going to have to judge, you know, whether he or she thinks it was, you know, what we learned was worth it or not.
A minute left, Fred, or maybe less than that. Are whistleblowers heroes?
Yeah, I think they're heroes because they do something the rest of us are afraid to do or afraid even to see. And they serve the rest of us. You simply can't find out about so many things unless somebody from the inside remembers that they also belong to the outside. To be a whistleblower is to remember you're a citizen, even though you're working inside an organization that demands loyalty to itself, that you belong to a larger body, you know, called your country. And that deserves your first loyalty. Sure, they're heroes. Doesn't mean every single one is a hero, but most of them are.
Wow, really well said. Great way to end. Again, the book, Whistleblowers, Broken Lives, and Organizational Power. Amazon, check it out. Get it anywhere. Indigo here in Canada. C. Fred Alford, thanks for joining us tonight. Great work. Continued success. We'll catch up with you down the line.
Okay, thank you, Richard.
Great show tonight. Well said. And a subject that I think if you haven't gone down the rabbit hole, investigated yourself, you should, because you'd be shocked to find out how many people stepped up, did the right thing, and unfortunately ended up on the wrong side of it. It is What in the World? Canada Talk, Sirius XM, Channel 167.